So as Joe said previously, I'm not Mark Halpern, but these are Mark's slides. So hopefully I'll do them justice because I was in this session for most of the time, and I can admit that Ken saw the light and came into the session at the end, so this is where he defected to. So these are some of the things that, some of the members that were there. In a nutshell, these are the five key factors that we spent the time discussing as the key business challenges facing, whether it's appification or democratization or expanding the use of simulation analysis and systems engineering software. So the first one, I'll go into a little bit detail on some of these other ones as well, but licensing models was probably the longest part of the discussion, partly because I was in there. And I am on that side of the fence that says, I'm a consumer of this software, and we have to do this better. But we did talk a bit about web and mobile and the impact of cloud specifically as a delivery mechanism for this kind of data or solutions. The value prop specifically is key. Just as Keith mentioned, you know, we need to get the message to the CXO, the Office of the Chief Executives, but we need everybody below them to carry that message correctly. They have to be ready to carry that message. It can't just be an external party, although sometimes that works better, depending on the company, carrying it. But the people below them, you can't have the CEO decide, we're going to go do this, and nobody else believes in it in the rest of the organization. But that communication with non-technical executives, in many cases, if you can convince the CFO that this is actually going to make the company money, it just smooths all the rails out and it just flows right through the company and it's not a problem. Even though they have nothing to do with execution, they hold the purse strings and it's very important to get them on your side. And finally, tapping the subject matter experts, in this case, not small and medium enterprise, but subject matter experts, and making sure that they're part of that whole process. So divided it up into challenges, impact, proposals. This is on all five of those. The challenge, frankly, is not just that they're expensive and restrictive, but I picked on myself. I said, I have 425 engineering tools. Now, granted, some of those are PLM, ALM, CAD, but the vast majority are CAE and EDA. And the licensing model is different from every company. And it's very, very difficult to expand the use of the most expensive tools, which is typically analysis, simulation, and systems engineering, to a broader consumer base inside my company if we don't have a better model for how and where they're using it and what we have to pay for each of those people. Because of that restrictive nature, it's very, very difficult to do things like experiment and have a non-experienced user that is, or at least an partially experienced user that's not an expert, use the tool if it's costing them $200,000 a year to use the tool. That's just prohibitive. You can't live in that environment. So we said, a pay by the drink, a proposal of some form of pay as you go that needs to be tiered because it needs to take into account some of those other things that we talked about in terms of mobile cloud and some of the other delivery mechanisms that are available. And frankly, we need more participation from the solution providers in delivering the education that we need, not just to our users that we have today, but to Mark's point earlier, to the grad and undergraduate students that we're going to be hiring in the next few years, so they at least have the exposure to a broad set of these tools, maybe not the individual tools, of course we use everything, but the individual tools that any one company might use. There is a problem, not just because it's a vendor business practice, but it's also a problem because it's the law for how they report revenue and how they generate the reports that they have to do in their accounting systems. So sometimes it's their hands are tied. That's how they did the disclosure statement. That's how they're allowed to recognize revenue. And it's a complete shift in business practice for them to change their licensing model. So that is definitely a problem. But we'd love to be able to promote that pay-as-you-go, help the vendors understand what that voice of the customer is really saying. I can pick on just about any solution provider and talk about ways that, while it appears on the surface, they're doing us a favor by switching to a, for example, a token-based solution. Over the course of 5 years, which is what I have to use to forecast the investment summary of anything that I buy, including software, over the course of 5 years, it actually cost me more in a token-based environment. So at least on the four that I've investigated so far. Web, cloud, and mobile, it's difficult, again, directly related to the other piece in terms of trust. The good thing is, from all the experience that I've had with it, which is not that long, I think the first time sharing system I used was in 1982, so I haven't been doing it that long. It is actually more secure. But most of the IT departments don't understand that. They think it's less secure because it's not on my premises and it's not within my firewalls. So there's a tremendous difficulty or a tremendous inhibitor from traditional practices, because at the end of the day, it's software. So the engineering community doesn't control it. IT controls that in most organizations. Now that IT may be one person, maybe 500 people, they may be dedicated to engineering software, but they're still IT, not engineers. So there's still some limits to what they know and how to be able to do that. If we can get more of this software delivered in this manner, I'm thinking specifically with web and cloud, we can get to that point where we can do pilot offerings that aren't prohibitively expensive for the consumers and aren't prohibitively cost negative for the suppliers, so you're not losing money and not having to manage that process of licensing. It's much, much easier to take a license away when it's running on your cloud than it is when it's running on my internal license server. And we need to educate, and frankly, it is evolving. Everybody, every software vendor is trying to come up with new ways. I think I'm on the sixth licensing methodology from one of my suppliers. So that's a little bit extreme, but they're all trying. Sometimes it's to drive revenue. I recognize that. So that's why I say, no, I'll stick with what I've got. But sometimes it is, in fact, to be able to help us do that pay-as-you-go and leverage some of these new technologies in a more effective manner. We need to document, as a community, I think, the value proposition that Stasis provides. If we can't demonstrate, frankly, not a specific return on investment in the software, but the fact that it actually increases revenue for the company, because I can deliver a more robust product earlier and faster that decreases my cost of poor quality, that drives revenue at the top line and therefore at the bottom line. And that's what the CFO understands. When I just say it's going to cost me $200,000, but I'm going to be able to do all this work, they don't understand what I'm talking about. When I can demonstrate the value that is the driving factor for that consuming company, that's what makes a difference. Without being able to do that, I also have that problem of getting more skilled users, getting more clarification on where and how to use it. And frankly, that's a culture thing. That's why it has to go to the office of the CXO. F, in my particular case, is critically important. The chief financial officer has to be involved and understand what that value is. And hopefully we can be more aggressive. So I know that I'm also see many of the people here at many, many different conferences throughout the year from different software suppliers as they go through that process, as well as other events like CIC and GPDIS. And my focus in all of those conferences is typically on engineering analysis and simulation. That's the piece that I benefit most from in attending all of those. But we need to do more in that area and get all of those communities actively engaged in where and how we can make this stuff more effective. Second to last was, again, the non-technical executives. I keep coming back to this because if we get their attention, if we have that simulation for executives, what does it mean to me to be able to run systems engineering more effectively, and how that improves the environment? Frankly, I don't know anybody in my industry that wants to continue to provide what one of our CEOs said about 20 years ago, a bag of parts. We are a system integrator and a system supplier. All of our competition is as well. And if we can't do systems engineering effectively because we are hiring the right people and we're demonstrating the business metrics through simple metaphors that they can understand, and not driving the details about where and how it works and how we have to have traceability from the requirement through all of the tiers of the design down to the individual module that's in the embedded software and do verification and validation, I lost them as soon as I said traceability. I can't live in that environment. It has to be something that they can understand. So hopefully some of what Keith talked about in terms of that message and how we deliver it and how we can get that out in the media, how we can get it out. How could we get something published in a Wall Street Journal that talks about how one of the use cases that we might come up with in Assess actually delivered value to a company? Because that's obviously not going to be a technical presentation if it's in the Wall Street Journal, and it's going to be speaking to the right audience. So that's hopefully something that we can do. And then finally, those subject matter experts, if only the experts use it every single day, I could go back and probably figure out how to set up a MATLAB model, but I haven't done that in 18 years probably. So it's highly doubtful that it'd be very successful. However, if I had an engineer with a lot less experience than I am, but he did it 6 months ago, I expect him to be able to do it again. But if I set it up such that he doesn't have to know all the nuances, it's appified, it's democratized to the point where he just has to be able to put those boundary conditions in, put those load factors in, and the rest of the process is one where we've captured the knowledge of the subject matter experts and wrapped that solution with that knowledge so that they can execute it in design and the rest of engineering and not just by those subject matter experts. I think it's important. And one of the keys, there is an initiative by COMSOL to actually certify COMSOL users. So they can say point blank, we've recognized that they have value. The CATIA user group that I've been a member of forever, which are now changing our name, but we're keeping the acronym because we're covering all the Dassault brands. We're working on certifications, not just from CATIA, but also for Innovia, and also for Simulia, and also for Delmia, so that if you're a member of our community, you can be recognized as various levels of expertise with those tools. And we need to be able to help do that, not just the user communities, but the software vendors coming together and helping us achieve that certification and qualification so that we know that the person can actually do it, and that helps build that trust as well. So a big part of it, as we talked about during that day, was also standards. FMI is important. FMI helps us integrate those standards and move things back and forth together, but we need those certified consultants, if you will, that understand the multiple disciplinary issues, that understand where and how we have to exchange information within systems engineering to those people that are doing the systems and systems, and hopefully make applications that are not so general purpose, but are actually rich and satisfy the needs within that particular area. So I think that was it. Yes. So I'm sure there's a million questions, but I'll let Joe answer all of them. So.
No, you don't get away that easy, Bob.
I was in a room, so I guess
we got time for one question. Let's see. We got a microphone
Mike?
Coming.
Mike, Steve, go ahead and stand up.
Bob, you work for a company that makes complex aircraft systems, subsystems, whatever.
Yes.
Which of your executives is non-technical?
My CFO, my chief marketing officer, my...
Your marketing officer isn't an engineering type?
No. He came out of a different part of the business.
Gee, I'm glad I drove.
Yeah. My vice president of supply chain, obviously my VP of HR, is far from technical. She has no idea what we're talking about. No, but she's on staff and she is there getting reports and she sometimes has a vote. Sometimes asks really pointed questions when she doesn't even know she did. So there's a lot. So the good thing is our CEO is, you know, grew up as an engineer, been an engineer for the company and other companies for a number of years, was a graduate of Georgia Tech. So I don't hold that against him, but he does have a technical background, so that's a good thing.